Well, hey, my name's Brad Bell. I pastor a church here in Fresno, California called the Well Community Church. We've been doing our thing here since about 2002. We're a multi-site church, kind of oopsed our way into that, drank the punch a couple years ago, and now we're living in the complexity that is multi-site. But it's been a ton of fun. We've got a younger dynamic at our church, so it's kind of a ton of fun and no budget, but truthfully, wouldn't want it any other way. So that's kind of our context. I've been married for 11 years to my bride, Jen, who is fantastic, great ministry partner. I've got two little girls, Kendall and Peyton. Kendall is three, Peyton is seven. And so we've got a lot of pink, a lot of princess, a lot of dress up that happens around our home. We've been asked to share kind of gut level stuff in 9 minutes or less, which I think is kind of funny because I don't know of any pastor in the country who can say what he needs to say in less than 9 minutes. So I will grossly overgeneralize, grossly oversimplify, but lay some things out to you that are kind of passions of mine. I'm going to work here just briefly from an assumption. The assumption is some of the other brothers that are going to be sharing here today are going to handle some of the issues that, in my opinion, are the top issues, like the handling of God's word, being a church that's driven by the teaching of the scriptures, a Christocentric church focused on the exaltation of Christ, a church that's committed to being a missional community, et cetera. And so if I could share anything with pastors, I'd probably get fired up about those issues. But my gut is that I'm going to play the odds here because I'm going to bet that the other folks that are communicating in this little nine series today are folks that are handling the scriptures, handling the admonition to be students of God's word, to accurately divide the truth, and in that to be a missional and Christocentric, gospel-centered church. And so I'm going to take another stab at this. I'm going to hit it from another direction. As I talk with pastors across the country and even just here in our city, it's interesting to me how many pastors have forgotten what it means to be a disciple. We spend so much time kind of preparing for messages and working on, you know, leadership issues and organizational structural stuff. And the leadership engines get fired up, the teaching engines get fired up, and we fail to remember that Christ has called us to abide in him, to be a disciple first. And so I think what I want to just kind of address is that the whole inner life of the leader, the idea that as pastors, we have got to walk with God, we have got to read our Bibles, we have got to read not just for a message prep, but we've got to read for us. Like the Word of God has got to do something in us. I heard Professor Howard Hendricks say one time that if you want your people to bleed, you as a leader have to hemorrhage, which means like Nehemiah, our heart has to break for the things that break the heart of God, that we need to be people who read the Word of God, not as those to read it just to teach it, but those who read it that it might do something in us. Because if it's not working in us, then what do we have to share? What do we have other than downloaded messages from someone else's quiet times with God that we're now regurgitating for the masses? It's got to happen in us. It's got to do something in us. Years ago, we started here at the church by the admonition of Wayne Cordero doing a kind of a through the Bible in a year kind of reading plan. I'll tell you what, that has been the best thing I have done in my spiritual life, to just sit down and read the word. Because truthfully, I'm not drawn to Ezekiel. I don't wake up at night going, man, I can't wait to read Leviticus. But there's good stuff in there. There's good stuff that impacts my life. And so I encourage you, as a leader in your church, whether it's male or female, spend time in your Bible and sit with God. Learn how to pray. Learn how to cultivate that time with the Lord. Nobody feels competent praying. Let's be honest. I mean, we feel like total morons. We scrape the Milky Way for about 30 seconds. We've shared everything we could ever imagine sharing. And then we're sitting there, kind of naked before God, so to speak. It's like Henry Nouwen talks about, we've got these proverbial monkeys dancing around in our mind like monkeys in a banana tree. And it's hard to sit, especially for most leaders that are dynamic type A leaders. They don't sit much and they don't ponder. They don't reflect. And I know that the contemplatives have driven the spiritual life for many years. And I'd rather beat myself to death with my Bible than sit and have a quiet time, just me and my journal. But truthfully, there's other ways you can do it, bringing people involved with you, spend time in your Bible in groups with folks, doing devotional type readings that can literally transform you. I think the second part of that, not only does a leader need to be a disciple, I think a leader needs to take care of themselves. We tend to run at Mach 1, and in that we sacrifice everything for the church, which I understand. I mean, Christ said, if you don't deny yourself, take up your cross, follow him. If you don't hate mother and father, even your own life, you can't be a disciple. Look, I get that. What I don't understand is folks that are masochistic in the way they pursue Jesus to the absolute detriment of their soul. So they run at Mach 1. They've got their cell phones always to their ear. The iPhone, great, great tool. But my goodness, it invades every second of my life if I'm not careful. And so chances are you're like that. And so my admonition to you is take care of yourself. Eat right. Work out. Go get on a bike and pedal with anger. Drop drops of stress on the floor in some gym somewhere. Throw on some headphones. Disappear in your own world and just recharge your body. Go get a massage. I know it sounds kind of corny and a bit odd, but it'll help you a ton to create a sense of sustainability. And then with that, recognize that nobody else is going to care about your schedule like you need to. So carve out time. Take a day away. Just disappear for a day once a month and go to the mountains or go to the beach or wherever you can get away and just sit and pray. Don't go prep. Don't go dream. Don't go vision cast. Just go sit. Go take a nap. Go for a walk. Go walk on the grass with your shoes off. Enjoy time just for you and God to just reconnect. I think if a leader neglects their inner life, whether it be being a disciple or whether it be the physical side of it, it's only a matter of time till you flame out. The stories of godly men and women who have totally flamed out in ministry are a dime a dozen. You want to make a difference? Make a difference in the long haul. Set yourself up to win so that 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years down the road, you're still banging away for the Lord and healthy. I think the final thing that I'd admonish you in, take care of your marriage. Nobody cheers that on anymore. Look, pastors, I know, especially for you senior leaders, you're up early. You're eating the bread of painful labor. You bust it all day. You come home totally waxed. Your kids jump on your lap. It's all you can do to kind of play with them and get them to bed without, you know, snapping in anger or being frustrated with them. And then your bride looks at you and you're like, look, I got nothing else to give. Hey, if that's the case, we got to recognize and admit the fact that we are neglecting the most important ministry that God would have for you, which is the ministry to your wife. So those of you that are married, make sure you take care of mama. For you ladies that are in leadership, make sure you take care of that man. Because here's the deal. If the marriage falls apart, it's over. Doesn't matter how good you teach. Doesn't matter how great you lead. Doesn't matter how many people you've led to Christ. I don't care what the community thinks about you. If your marriage falls apart, you're done. So focus on that. Take care of that. You're not going to oops yourself into a healthy marriage. You're going to have to cultivate that over time. Hey, if you're in a dark place, repent. Do the deeds you did at first and return. Go back. Date again. Love that spouse. Make sure you cultivate that. And I think the final admonition, as my time's running out here, is for those of you who have kids, you need to recognize that the greatest church you pastor is the church at home. The woman who calls you husband, the kids who call you daddy. That is the most important investment of your time, is to pour into those kids. Why is it that pastors' kids stereotypically have a terrible reputation? It's because mom or dad gives everything they've got to the church and gives their kids their scraps. If that's the case, shame on us. Because there ought to never be a time where our kids feel like they don't have us and all of us. We've got to give everything we can to the sustainment of our devotional life, to the sustainment of our physical life, to the cultivation of our marriage, and to the raising of godly kids. You ask at the end of the day, what would honor God? That is what honors God. And yet that gets second-tier press and second-tier motivation from just about everybody I talk to. If I had 9 minutes, that's what I'd want to say to you.